Minister Indranee Rajah.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I thank the NMPs for moving this motion on the important topic of education. They have put the focus on the love of learning as a driving force for education and called for the government and people to work together to ensure that education is accessible, inclusive and lifelong. I would also like to thank Ms. Rahayu for her amendments, which help to flesh out how we should do this and provides the frame for the action plan, as well as all the members who have spoken and contributed to this debate. Listening to the speeches, there are some key themes which emerge. The first is that parents want reassurance that their children will have a bright future and that they will not lose out. We have heard much about a future-ready education system, stress, competition, the PSLE, lifelong learning, inclusivity. All these are really different aspects of the same concern, which is trying to ensure that your child has the best possible chance to succeed. Second, even as we want our children to get ahead, there is also a strong sentiment that we want our children to be able to enjoy their years in school. Mr. Lewis Ng, Mr. Darrell David, and Mr. Kok Heng Yun spoke about this. We don't want the children's years in school to be only about homework, tests, assessment, grades, and exam scores. It must also be an enjoyable educational experience built around the love of learning, of exploration, and of play. It must be holistic, teaching skills like critical thinking to prepare them for the new world ahead. And it must have the emotional well-being of students at heart. Mr. Ganesh Rajaram and Ms. Kwek Shao Yin also spoke about the need to change our culture, that as teachers, parents, and a society, we need to give our children space to grow. We need to listen to them better in order to support them better. Third, many of you also spoke about how this love of learning must be a lifelong one. Ms. Thanalechmi, Mr. Randolph Tan, and Mr. Darrell David urged that our children must continue to learn after they leave school and throughout their working lives. Employees and employers alike must be nimble and receptive to on-the-job training. Fourth, this debate reflects our social conscience. Many MPs, including Mr. Madev Mohan, Ms. Kwek Shao Yin, and Mr. Azmun Ahmad, raised the issue of inequality. You worry that the vulnerable, the disabled, and the low-income will not be able to get as much out of the education system as those who are better off, that they will get left behind, and that the gap is widening. This shows that as a people, we care about those who are disadvantaged. A fifth common theme was that of inclusivity, integration, social mixing. Ms. Rahayu, Ms. Chayong Yong, and Mr. Henry Kwek spoke passionately about this. We are concerned that children born with special needs will go through life without being embraced or valued by society. We are concerned that the divide between rich and poor, or between children from different backgrounds and communities, may grow. And this is important because it says something about our values and the kind of society we want, the kind of people that we are, and we want a society that is more equal, more unified. Last, there was a call for us to work together to achieve these goals. Ms. Denise Pua spoke about the need for government to tap on the ideas, expertise of stakeholders to develop policies and programs together as we shape an education system for the future. On all these broad objectives, we are aligned. These are MOE's objectives too. We want every child to have a bright future and to do well. Like MPs who have spoken, we want them to have a wonderful school experience. We're also concerned about the vulnerable, and we want integration and inclusivity to be at the heart of our education system. Where we may differ in some aspects is on the strategies or solutions. But let me reassure the House that we are very much at one in terms of the overall aims and objectives. Minister Ong and SPS Faisal have already explained some of our ministry's programs and the considerations behind our work. So let me wrap up MOE's response by sharing with the House where we are coming from in terms of the big picture, our mission, what we have done, what we are doing, and what we will be doing. Every day, many vehicles and pedestrians go past the MOE signage along North Buena Vista Road. Most people don't stop to examine the signage, but if you did, you would see MOE's mission statement on it, which is molding the future of the nation. It's a mission we take very seriously. MOE has walked a life journey, not just with the nation, but also with every Singaporean who has passed through the education system. And let me show you this journey through the eyes of three generations of women. When Singapore achieved independence in 1965, Madam Iris Wong was 11 years old. She used to walk through the hot sun to May South Primary School. School was often disrupted because of social unrest and racial riots. In those early years, as a fledgling nation, MOE played a key role in racial harmony and integration, bringing children together in a national school system. Our priority was for a newly independent country was mass education for a young population and to help people get jobs in an era of industrialization. Madam Wong's education journey ended after secondary four, which was considered quite a high attainment in those days. She began work in her father's tailoring shop and had three children, one of whom was a daughter, Josephine. Josephine went to Outram Primary in the 1980s. She drank milk out of little plastic packets and she brushed her teeth over the school drain, as I did when I went to primary school in the 1970s. In the 1970s, we had milk too, because milk was to help children get strong bones, because at that time, rickets were still a problem due to poor nutrition in a country that was still not well off. By Josephine's time, the economy had changed. We were moving up the value chain from a lower skill manufacturing base, which was producing things like fish hooks and matches, to a more capital intensive and a high skills economy, producing electronics and petrochemicals. The education system had to adapt to equip Singaporeans to thrive in this new situation and also to address high dropout rates. That was when streaming was introduced to cater to the different learning paces of our children. The school dropout rate fell sharply after streaming. Attrition for the first primary school cohort that was streamed was about 1 in 10 students, as compared to the previous rates of 1 in 3. Josephine left school, she went to poly, she worked for a few years, and then she got a degree in marketing communications. By the time she was being courted by her husband-to-be in the 2000s, the education system was coming of age and undergoing a paradigm shift. We had entered the phase of the knowledge-based economy, where ideas and information are the key drivers of growth. We needed a people with entrepreneurial spirit, the ability to innovate, and we had to build intellectual capital. So then Prime Minister Mr. Goh Chok Tong introduced a new education philosophy, Thinking Schools, Learning Nation, that reduced curriculum time to make room for more inquiry-based activities that would develop creativity and critical thinking. We also gave greater autonomy for schools to be innovative in programs and invested in information and communications technology. To deliver this, we hired more teachers and strengthened teachers' professional development to improve teaching quality. In the 2000s, to cater to new and different aspirations, MOE introduced more choice, diversity, and flexibility in terms of types of schools and programs. In 2010, Josephine gave birth to a beautiful baby girl, Vera. Vera is now 8 years old. She started primary school in CHIJ Toa Payoh last year. The future that she faces will be very different from that of her grandmother and her mother. The beginning of this decade, when she was born, marked the end of the global financial crisis and the beginning of what we call the future economy. The future economy calls for a very different sort of education from that undertaken by Iris and Josephine. It will be a VUCA environment, volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous. it's a future driven by the need for skills, innovation, adaptability, and flexibility. It will be disrupted by technology. It will see the weight of the global economy shift towards Asia. And members have correctly identified that our education system needs to be able to respond to this. And in fact, MOE has already embarked on this. We are undertaking a transformational change for the next phase in our development. And the reason that I went through this history of MOE is really to show that at each stage, as times change, MOE has responded. Our education has responded. It has adapted and adjusted in order to walk that journey with the nation and with Singaporeans. So where are we at now? Now, it's really about developing each individual and creating multiple pathways. First, we now put a lot more emphasis on developing the whole child, not just the academic achievements. And this is key to our student-centric, values-driven philosophy. I know people don't like jargon like student-centric, but basically what it means is we put the child at the center of it and we build around that. So MOE's approach is actually best reflected in our 21st century competency framework. I've asked the clerk to put copies of this on the members' chairs. You may see it. And if I could ask you to refer to it. It's often referred to as the MOE Swiss role, but I think if you want to be technically correct, it should be an Arctic role. Baby boomers will know which ice cream I'm referring to. If you look at it, you will see that at the core of the framework is values. Because at the end of the day, the most important thing is for the individual is what kind of person, your character. So values is at the core of it. And this ties in with character and citizenship development that we have made as a central part of our education system. The next two rings reflect the social and emotional skills that our children will need to navigate the world ahead. And the outermost ring shows what kind of people we eventually want them to be. Confident, able to learn on their own, contributing actively in all their undertakings to society and to be good citizens. So for the members who have spoken about the need for character, for good attributes, please be assured that this is actually a focus of our education system. Next, we have to ensure that our children will attain knowledge, to have a solid foundation in literacy and numeracy. But this book knowledge alone is not enough. This year, the Organization for the Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, published a paper entitled Education 2030, The Future of Education and Skills. Future-ready students will need broad knowledge, but also practical skills like the ability to utilize new technology. These skills will be in great demand by employers. And even this is not enough. The churn and the change caused by technology and other disruptive factors means that learning has to continue well into adult life. The ability to learn, unlearn, and relearn will be key. Much of the stress that we have talked about is really driven by the assumption that there is only one path to success, the academic route. This has led to a fear that if children do not get into certain schools or into the express stream, then they will not have a bright future. However, there are, in fact, many different paths to success. Different children have different personalities, talents, and abilities. Some are more academically inclined, others are much better with their hands, or are more creative and artistic. And different children respond differently to different methods of teaching. The future economy will be much more diverse than today. Doctors, lawyers, engineers, architects, and accountants will still be around, but the way that they do their jobs will be very different. There will be increased demand for jobs in new areas like financial technology, data analytics, artificial intelligence, and virtual reality. Dell Technologies recently released a report based on a survey of 3,800 business leaders across the world. It estimated that 85% of the jobs in 2030 have not even been invented yet. So when Vera enters the workforce, in about 15 years, she may well take on a job that we have not even conceived of today. And yet, it's our task to prepare her for it, for a job that we don't even know is going to come into existence yet. And for that, you cannot have a system that is one size fits all. Nor is there any longer a single measure of success, and learning has to be lifelong. In recognition of this, we have over the years introduced different types of schools and programs to cater for the different strengths and talents of different individuals. We have the usual O and A level route, but we also have established the integrated program in various schools to give students more time to immerse themselves in broader learning experiences. We have the sports school to cater for sporting talent, and the school of the arts for those artistically inclined. And we have the NUS High School of Math and Science for those who are STEM inclined, and the School of Science and Technology, which focuses on STEM as well, but their curriculum also centers on applied and interdisciplinary learning. Then we have CREST and Spectra Secondary Schools to cater to students who would benefit from a skills-based, hands-on curriculum. And there's Northlight and Ascension Pathway to cater for those who may otherwise be at risk of leaving school prematurely. We have secondary schools with enhanced art and music programs. Mr. Kok Hing Loon spoke passionately about arts and the humanities. I would encourage Mr. Kok and all members here to visit the Singapore Youth Festival Art Exhibition, which is just next door at the National Gallery. You would be amazed at the quality of some of the artwork that is being produced by our students. More recently, we have introduced applied learning programs in all secondary schools. Changkat Changi Secondary School, whose program, aptly entitled SOAR, partners aviation industry giants to give students opportunities to deepen their understanding of aeronautics. This is at secondary school. And Teck Whye Primary School, where students are introduced to design thinking concepts using 3D printing technologies to bring their projects to life. We have adjusted the system for different aptitudes and paces of learning. While streaming in schools, the old EM1, EM2 and EM3 system did achieve the objective of lowering attrition rates, it also had the effect of too sharply categorizing students at an early stage and did not sufficiently allow for the fact that different students may have different strengths in different subjects. So in its place, we introduced differentiated learning, which recognizes that different children have different strengths and also learn different subjects at different paces. This is the subject-based banding, where students can take combinations of standard and foundation subjects. At secondary school, the express, normal academic, and normal technical streams cater for the different talents, strengths, and abilities of the students, and we have now also extended subject-based banding to cover both the lower and upper secondary levels. We also have many more subjects and many more subject combinations. Students can dabble in food and consumer education, stand at workbenches filling in with different ingredients instead of their usual desks, or they can take China studies to learn about the complexities of Chinese society. In our institutions of higher learning, we now also have subjects which were unknown to parents when they were in school. Singapore Poly's diploma in perfumery and cosmetic science taps into a growing global market for fragrance products. At least 5 of the world's top flavor and fragrance houses are now based in Singapore, and these students' skills will be highly valued. ITE offers a higher NITEC in game art and design, where you can learn how to create unforgettable characters and entire virtual worlds. And our students are so good. They create games that end up being finalists in showcases like the Tokyo Game Show. Then, in addition to all of this, we have created multiple pathways to success. Post-secondary, we now have the ITE with 3 campuses, 5 polytechnics, and 6 autonomous universities. Many members of this House will remember the recommendations of the Aspire report, which was debated in this chamber and which evolved to become Skills Future. The end result of that report was more applied learning, more career options, more career progression. We established the Polytechnic Foundation Programme for early entry into poly, and the ITE Work-Learn Technical Diploma so that students can undergo apprenticeships and study at the same time. When students graduate, they can continue to learn, making use of their SkillsFuture credits or part-time courses for adults. Traditional universities like NUS and NTU, based on the British model, or SMU, which is more a US-style business school. In the last few years, we have added three newly publicly funded universities, SUTD for engineering, computing, and architecture, SIT for science and technology, and SUSS for the social sciences. And SIT and SUSS have a more applied pedagogy and curriculum. So there are many different ways to reach an ultimate goal. You can go the academic route from secondary to JC to university, or to poly, then work, or attend ITE and then work through the Work-Learn Technical Diploma, or go to ITE and then poly, then uni, or go to poly, work, and then move on to university, or other professional certifications. There are multiple permutations. We have made SkillsFuture a movement for lifelong learning, supported by the many SkillsFuture programs under MOE, as well as the Adapt and Grow program under MOM. Minister Ong also recently announced at the ITE graduation ceremony on 3rd July that working adults will be able to apply to polytechnics via the early admissions exercise from 2020 onward. This means that adults can secure places in diploma courses through course-specific talents because the polys will better recognize work experience instead of relying only on academic results. So this is yet another example of our commitment to ensuring that people have many opportunities to progress. That said, we do acknowledge that there are concerns about over-drilling and an over-emphasis on grades. We, on our part, have made moves to reduce PSLE stress. We stopped revealing the top PSLE scores. We removed banding of schools by academic results. We're now going one step further, as announced previously. In 2021, we will be making changes to the PSLE scoring and Secondary 1 posting systems. We will replace the T-score with wider scoring bands, and this means that there will be only 29 possible PSLE scores compared to the more than 200 in the current system. This will reduce fine differentiation and comparison between students. It means more schools will share the same cutoff points. We will also introduce tiebreakers, choice, for example, that are not related to academic results. Now on to inclusivity. SPS Faisal has addressed this, but let me just affirm that this is an area in which we want to provide the best possible support to those with special needs, and it will continue to be an important part of our work. Ms. Chia Yong Yong spoke very passionately just now on this topic. And to Ms. Chia, I would like to say that she's definitely not a burden. In fact, she's very much a blessing. Her disability, or rather special ability, has enabled her to give this House insights and perspectives that we would not otherwise have had. And this has enriched our debate and informed our policy, and enabled, and her presence here has given us a much more positive contribution. So this is the value and the benefit of inclusivity and being able to draw on people of different talents and different abilities. We will continue to ensure that education remains an integrating force that brings everyone together. Now on the joy of learning. Many members spoke about this and the importance of giving students time and space to discover who they are. We've shared their concerns about the culture of over-drilling and over-testing. We agree. Nurturing a love for learning in our students is equally important to us. We start early, from the preschool years. Our Nurturing Early Learners curriculum, as Mr. Lewis Ng pointed out, recognizes the importance of purposeful play. This framework is shared with the entire preschool sector. the Early Childhood Development Agency's regulations have also placed more emphasis on outdoor play and physical development. We've taken steps to unlock curiosity and encourage the joy of learning in our teaching pedagogies. So, for example, our programs for active learning and learning through unstructured play, where children can engage in free, open-ended and free play. In Pongal Primary, teachers set up stations full of supplies for children, nets, leaves, twigs to create their own rules and games. At Yangqing Primary, students learn English through performing and dramatizing stories together. Teachers also create games to teach math. We are facilitating sharing among educators on how to adopt innovative and engaging teaching practices so that students will enjoy learning through initiatives like Singapore Teaching Practice and online portal for teachers. We acknowledge sentiments from the public, from the House, about how we can work to free our students from the never-ending worksheets and tests. So, for example, Keming Primary School is exploring moving away from common tests, which used to take up about 3 weeks of curriculum time, to regular checkpoint assessments instead, so that more time is freed up for other learning experiences. MOE's Director General of Education, Mr. Wong Siew Hong, recently sent a note round to the fraternity. In it, he affirmed the good work of teachers, and he also encouraged everyone to adopt a spirit of introspection, to reflect on whether some of our practices, despite being done out of love for the child, may have unintended consequences. For example, by giving them too many tests, which may deprive them of time for other activities. So we will do our part, but we do need the parents and other stakeholders to do their part too. Mr. Lewis Ng called for a review of the performance-based ranking for teachers because he was concerned that they might teach for the test. I would like to reassure Mr. Ng and members that actually teacher performance is assessed holistically and is not dependent on their students' academic performance. So the teachers are assessed on a wide range of criteria: quality teaching and learning, character development of students, professional development of self and others, and a demonstrated desired, and whether they demonstrate desired personal attributes, professional values, ethics, content mastery, and pedagogy of instruction. Next, bridging gaps. Members have expressed concerns about students who are less well off and disadvantaged. We pay a lot of attention to this group with interventions and financial assistance. And this has enabled students from disadvantaged backgrounds to do better. Today, 9 out of 10 students in the lowest SES quintile progress to post-secondary education, up from 5 in 10, or 50%, 10 years ago. We top the world PISA scores in mathematics, science, reading, and collaborative problem solving. We also top the world in TIMSS, the Trends in International Mathematics and Science Study in Maths and Science. We're number 2 in the world in PIRLS, the Progress and International Reading Literacy Study. What this shows us is this. There are high peaks. We have one of the highest proportion of students performing at the highest levels of proficiency, about 1/3 to half of our students. Mr. Madev Mohan asked if this means that our Singapore students are ready for the brave new world. The fact that our students come out tops in collaborative problem solving is promising because it measures not just their content knowledge, but their ability to work with others, to communicate, and to solve complex problems. And this will serve us in good stead for the future. However, what is also notable about these results is that there are no deep valleys, meaning that we have one of the smallest proportions of low performers in PISA, TIMSS, and PIRLS. What this means is that our schools are supporting students from all socioeconomic backgrounds to do well, and that they do better than their peers in other countries. Nevertheless, like members who have spoken today, we too are concerned about the widening income gap, even as the middle class are uplifted and do better over time. So the solution is to uplift those at the lower end and close the gap, without chopping the top and holding back those who do well, as Minister Ong spoke about just now. This is something we are committed to do. I also want to say that what drives much of our work to support and uplift students are our committed educators, who are the heart of the system. It is our educators who motivate students and who identify opportunities for them. For example, Outram Secondary School has a remarkable principal, Mr. Boo Hyun Kok. He formed a task force consisting of teachers and student welfare officers to address long-term absentee cases, the children who didn't turn up for school. For those teachers, their calendar is cleared for the first few periods in the morning. If the students don't turn up by 8 a.m., these teachers will make phone calls, they will visit the homes, they will knock on the doors, and they encourage the families to send them to school. The task force makes a special effort to understand and empathize with the family's difficulties. They build rapport so that the family trusts that the school has the child's welfare at heart. And this has helped many students, like Jimmy, not his real name, feel welcome and safe. He used to skip school because his stepmother has a chronic illness and he had to buy her meals. With the school's help, he now stays with his grandparents, who are better able to care for him. He loves soccer, so the school placed him in a special soccer program to encourage him to come back, and his attendance is now regular. In the 3 years since the task force was set up, Outram Secondary has managed to reduce their long-term absenteeism rate by half. Finally, let me say something about partnership. At the end of the day, you can see that all of us, parents, teachers, MOE, we all want the same thing. We want our children and our people to do well. We want them to have an enjoyable an education as possible, and we want them to enjoy learning. The key is in striking the right balance and having the right mindset. On balance, Mr. Louis Ng called on us to de-emphasize academic content and to emphasize play and exploration. At the same time, Mr. Randolph Tan cautioned that the last thing we want to do is for everyone to discard the foundations currently offered by our education system, and that having a solid foundation in the basics also prepares them for self-directed learning throughout the rest of their lifelong journey as a learner. So both of them have slightly different perspectives, but on the spectrum. The question is, where do you set the balance? And that is MOE's task, and that is what MOE strives to do. We've already embarked on the shifts which embody much of what members have called for. We're not removing PSLE, but the transformation is still taking place as we move more to applied learning. The process is ongoing, and we do welcome the ideas and suggestions that have been put forward by members today. Mr. Nees Poor called for a committee to develop an education master plan. The form that this takes is perhaps not so critical, but the key thrust of her suggestion is that achieving our education objectives is really a partnership between all stakeholders, and we will continue to engage and hear from the House, from parents, from teachers, from our youth themselves. And the other important part is mindset. I've already outlined some of the steps that we are taking to reduce stress, to try and create a better, more important and more supportive environment for our children by telling them and society that there is much more to life than just grades. But mindset is a difficult thing to change. It takes time. And so we call on all partners to do this. As I was reading the newspapers today, I flipped to the forum page and I saw a letter written by a young 17-year-old junior college student, Teo Chen Wei. He was talking about PSLE. He wondered whether removing the T-score might help, or whether it might actually result in, you know, other ways, other means of stress. But the most telling thing about his letter was this. He said, "The most effective way to improve the education system is for parents and children to accept that failure in exams is not failure in life." And that is correct. So what are we doing? We're balancing various things. We want excellence, but excellence does not mean excellence purely in academic grades alone. There are many other paths, as I have pointed out. So you could be excellent in aeronautics, you could be excellent in culinary, whatever it is, but we want excellence because we want our people to do well. At the same time, does failure mean that you cannot progress? The answer is no, because we have created so many different pathways, and we hope that people will see a setback as just something from which to learn and to move forward. Much of the stress is driven by the belief that there is only a narrow gateway and one path to success. But as I have explained earlier, there are many different paths, and I would really urge parents and students to explore what is available and to choose the option that is right for a particular individual. There is a group of parents who have started a campaign, Life Beyond Grades, to demonstrate that the path to success does not depend on grades alone. Parenting is one of the toughest but most fulfilling roles, and they all just want the best for the child. So I hope that more people will adopt this kind of a mindset. Our system has enabled people to rise from disadvantaged circumstances and to do well. With the creation of multiple pathways, it means that there are many opportunities with potential for good outcomes. Not necessarily the same outcomes, but good outcomes for all. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I support the motion.